Hello, good evening to you. Welcome to the English Bible study. I hope that all of you are doing good, and I hope that you are ready to receive from the Holy Spirit. I take this as a great privilege. I count it as a great honor to teach the Word of God, and I take it very seriously. I spend a lot of time researching, studying, and spending quite a lot of time with resources to bring this study to you every Wednesday. Okay, so I hope that you take this study seriously and not only listen, but become a doer of the word. Amen. So let's pray and start. Precious Father, thank you, Lord, for bringing us once again on another Wednesday, Lord, to study your word. Lord, the more we eat your word, the more we spiritually mature. And Lord, when Mary chose to sit at your feet and learn, you said Mary has chosen the important thing. And this evening, we also have chosen the important things in your eyes, in your perspective. Sitting at your feet to study your word is the most important thing, God. And Lord, we know we have understood your priority. Therefore, we will never miss on it. In these latter days, Lord, we will become serious students of your word. And thank you, Father, for this opportunity. And also I pray and thank you, Holy Spirit of God, for being here to teach us and training me to teach your children, helping me to teach your children. I pray that every heart will be opened, every mind will be alert, that every environment will be peaceful to receive, and let Jesus' name be glorified, and everyone say amen. Okay, so what are we studying? New Testament survey, part 8 today. Joining us for the first time, welcome to the Wednesday Bible study. But you need to go and watch parts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 to listen to part 8, because otherwise you will be in a no man's land. You will not properly understand. So all our previous episodes of teachings on New Testament survey are archived in our website or YouTube channel. Please visit the link that is shown below and look at those studies, part 1 to 7, and then you can look at past 8. Okay, so all those who follow regularly, I hope that your Bible is ready, your book is ready. Let's dive into the study. Okay, so now what we are looking at in the last couple of weeks is the books or the epistles. There are 27 books in the New Testament, and we divided them into 5, and we saw the Gospels. We have done a study on the Gospels, not a deep study, not a very lengthy study, but on a very short study on the Gospels. And then we looked at the Romans, okay, last week, and the epistle of Romans. Now we are looking at Paul's letters, okay? So we looked at Paul's first letter, that is Romans. And now, today, we are going to look at the second letter of Paul wrote. Second letter was written to the Corinthians in the city of Corinth. He wrote 3 letters according to Bible theologians. One went missing, so we have 2 letters in our Bible, 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. Okay, so that's what we are going to look at. I want to just focus on one letter today and finish it and then stop the study so that you will not have too much of information and then you don't retain anything when you have too much of information. So let's focus on one letter today, the letters written to the Corinthians, okay? Now, listen to me. Some of the informations that I reveal here, I don't share them in our Sunday sermons, okay? Therefore, some of the things that we don't say on a Sunday in sermons will be shared here, precious people of God. The Bible studies are people who are maturing and matured. Okay, they want to go deeper in the Word of God. And so Bible studies of people who want to mature. But when you take on a Sunday, there are people from different walks of life and different levels of maturity come on a Sunday. There could be a newcomer. There could be a person who has just come to the Lord. Somebody who had never been to church would come on a Sunday, walk into Sunday service. So they will not be able to handle the information, these deep informations, what I'm going to share with you today. That's why as servants of God, as we preach on Sundays, we don't share these deep things because it's too much for people. And to understand the letter of the Corinthians better, we need to first understand about the city of Corinth, okay, and its culture. Now, when you read the book of Corinthians, now what I see today in Christendom or in the church circle is, what is written to the Corinthians is applied in churches directly without understanding the background to which background of the Corinth city or the background of the Corinthian people. What Paul wrote to the Corinthians, those things were taken directly and applied in today's churches, and which can absolutely mislead people, precious people of God. So some of the things Paul only exclusively wrote it for Corinthians. You don't see Paul writing it in any other letters, because there was a background to it for Paul to write like that. Because certain things were happening in the Corinthian city for Paul to write like that. And those kind of statements or writings, you will not find anywhere else in the Bible related to Paul writing to churches. None other church he wrote like that, only to the Corinthians. So the mistake that we do is we take those what Paul wrote to Corinthians directly and apply it in our churches and mislead people. Okay, so all of these doubts and all of these clarification that you need regarding what Paul wrote to the Corinthians, we're going to sort it out today. And I hope that you are ready. So to better understand the letters written to the Corinthians, you need to first of all understand the city of Corinth and the culture of the city of Corinth. Okay? Precious people of God, so let's dive in and find out what kind of a city was Corinth. Okay? Corinth was one of the worst cities. Okay? And morally corrupted city during that time, during the time of Paul. What was Corinth? Corinth is one of the worst city and morally corrupted city during Paul's time. Because why they were so morally corrupted and one of the worst cities? Because they were one of the richest city. Corinth was one of the richest city. They were so rich, and there were so many rich people. What was the reason for Corinth being a rich city is simply because there was a lot of inflow of foreign exchange. There were a lot of foreign exchange were flowing into the Corinth city. Now, Sri Lanka is struggling to have foreign exchange. Am I right? But Corinth during those times were full of foreign exchange. They were overflowing with foreign exchange. They were one of the richest city and the most corrupted city and the worst city at that time. Okay. The reason for them being so rich is the inflow of foreign exchange. And why there was so much of inflow of foreign exchange? Because, precious people of God, Corinth had two major harbors. Okay? Two major harbors where ships were going in and out of Corinth. And ships from Middle East, Europe, India, and so many other parts of the country would pass by Corinth. And then they would dock their ships for months in those two harbors, and a lot of foreigners were flowing into the city of Corinth because of these two major harbors. And Corinth was one of the trading, big time trading city at that time because of these two harbors. And all these ships would anchor at Corinth and stay for a few months. Therefore, these harbors were very busy, precious people of God. So Corinth was a corrupted and a worse city, but they were such a rich city because of the inflow of foreign exchange. Why was the inflow of foreign exchange? Because of these two major harbors. It was a trading city. So imagine people from all over the world would travel to Corinth. Africans, Europeans, Asians, Arabians, all, you know, nationality people would never pass by Corinth because the ships stopped there and dock for a few days. So these people come into the city, and the city was full of trade. Such was the city of Corinth during Paul's time. And also, Bible scholars say, in addition to the sea trade route, the highway of kings, it's called the highway of kings, constructed by the Romans, went through Rome. The highway of kings was like a broad road that Romans constructed to connect most part of the world with Rome. So this highway, now we have highways connecting us to many parts of the country. And a lot of people use those highways because, you know, it saves time for you and you can travel fast. So Romans built a highway, and this highway connected many parts of the world with Rome. And this highway went through Rome, went through Corinth. So that was a big highway of land route for trade running through Corinth. And there was trade route with because of these two harbors. And imagine the inflow of foreigners into this city. And just imagine the inflow of foreign exchange or foreign currency into this country, into this city. So Corinth was a rich city. Corinth was full of foreign exchange and inflow of foreign money. And Corinth was a worst and a corrupted city. This was Corinth during the time of Paul. Okay? So now, you can just think what kind of a city it would have been when I introduce this to you, when I reveal this to you. So a lot of foreign exchange, all sorts of foreigners, all business that prevailed in the Corinth city were to cater to the need of these foreigners. So there were a lot of business entities, trades happening in Corinth to cater to these foreigners who were flowing in to the city. It was a bustling city, a very busy city, city with a lot of people. And I want you to picture this. Now, when you know the background to a city, and then you read the letter that Paul wrote to this city, to the church in this city, you will understand well, people of God, why Paul wrote certain things. What was his intention? What was his motive? What was the idea behind of writing certain things in these letters? You will understand better. Okay? So we are looking at the second letter that Paul wrote, and that letter was to the Corinthians. Okay? Now, because of this background, Corinth city, all streets were filled with hotels and shops on both sides of the streets. Okay? Now, we also in Sri Lanka, we have few cities like that, no? What do you call holiday destination cities? Now, if you go to Galle Fort, it's like that. Have you been to Galle Fort? You know, on both sides, there are lot of small hotels and lot of business, small businesses. And, because a lot of foreigners come there. And then you go to New Aurelia. It is like that, the town. And then you go to Nigambu. There's something called C Street. You know, there are a lot of hotels and a small business entity. So Corinth was like that. All streets were filled with hotels, shops on both sides of the streets, hotels everywhere, small guest houses, you know, and little when you go away from the town, houses that will carry boards saying rooms available. When you go to New Delhi, you'll find that. When you go to Gaul, you will find that. When you go to Nigambu, you will find that. You know, little away from the city, you will see houses with boards, rooms available. Have you seen that? AC and non-AC and things like that. So Corinth was like that. The city was filled with a lot of hotels, motels, guest houses, and small shops with artifacts and ornaments and handmade crafts. And then houses carrying boards saying rooms available. Why? A lot of foreigners were flowing in. This was the city of Corinth. Use your imagination. Just use your imagination and see how Corinth city would have been. Now I can remember, you know, I come from New Aurelia. So during April season time, New Aurelia is a bustling and a busy city. Why? A lot of visitors come to New Aurelia. April, we know from March to April or February to April, Colombo gets so hot. Now all climatic conditions have changed, precious people of God. But those days, and even today, you can't predict the weather. Now I see now these days, Colombo early morning, it's very chill. I don't know whether you noticed. So people from Colombo would flock in when I was small and living in New Aurelia. We look forward to April season because why? All the Colombo crowd comes and these girls comes in short skirts and dresses and be in Colombo. New Aurelia boys were like shocked and they've never seen, you know, it's like a fashion parade in New Aurelia, and the ice cream van comes and so much of happening in New Aurelia city, and there's car races, motorcycle races, horse race, all flower shows, all sorts of things happening. Why? A lot of visitors flow in. And then one thing that I would see is that I lived a little away from the town, and when I walk towards my home, all the houses will carry this board. Rooms available, rooms available, rooms available. Why? All the hotels are overflowing. And then people who come, they just want to just stay a few days. They just take these one or two rooms and they, you know, manage with few families staying in, and then they go away. So this was the picture that you need to have about Corinth. Corinth was such a city. And it is the same picture that what I see in New Aurelia that I can see of Corinth. It was a holiday destination city. It was a trade city. It was a business epic center. It was a rich city, and it was a corrupted city. Okay? So, precious people of God, another important thing, okay? Another important thing you will see in Corinth city, because of the inflow of a lot of foreigners and visitors and a lot of ships come and docking at this harbor, where there is a lot of seamen, one thing that you will see. What is that? A lot of ships coming to a city, and a lot of seamen flocking into the city, and a lot of foreigners coming into the city. This one particular business you will see in that city. Can somebody tell me? What is that? The red light street, the prostitution, okay? And you know, the cities, holiday destination cities, and especially when foreigners are coming and a lot of ships are coming, this business has to be there. And Corinth was a city filled with prostitution. All the hotels had prostitutes. All the motels and guest houses had prostitutes. And even the small houses, because it was an accepted practice in Corinth. It was an approved practice in Corinth. It was a legal business in Corinth. And nobody saw it as something bad. So Corinth was a city filled with prostitution. Corinth city, all hotels had prostitutes, and they were prostitutes used to stand by the wayside, you know, and catering to all levels of men. And the price levels vary from dinar. Those days there were dinars, 1 dinar to 100 dinars. And even today, prostitutions are catered to different different status of people. Am I right? There are very expensive prostitutes, and there are prostitutes who are on the roads, you know, who are for the lower levels of people. And even if you say go to Dickman's Road today, or there are some very famous particular places where prostitutes used to stand and wait. And then, you know, when I come sometimes in the night, you know, Tanu is clueless of these things. And when we turn, down that overhead bridge, Devil, and go towards, Tanu says, look, this girl is waiting alone in this night. No, I said, no, man. She's waiting for business. What business? You know, so it's sad, precious people of God. It's sometimes sad. But what I say is, Corinth was such a city. Prostitutes used to be on the streets and call men, and then they bargain and go. And then there are the rich men who come and stay in big hotels, and then they are catered to according to their levels. You know, prostitutes are being given for different price. Corinth was such a city. Why am I saying all of this is? So now when you, after this introduction of the Corinth city, when you read the letter, you will better understand the letter. And you will know why Paul is writing certain things to the Corinthian church. So precious people of God, prostitution was big time in Corinth, the city of Corinth. Now, the other thing that I want to say is, now when a respectable family comes to Corinth, they will be reluctant to stay in such hotels. And Corinth, all hotels had prostitutes. All motels and guest houses and houses had prostitution. It was something that they didn't see as taboo or something bad. It was accepted a normal business trade. So say like Corinth was a holiday destination, a beautiful place, and there are a lot of things to explore. So when a good family, a respectable family comes to Corinth, they say like they're bringing a small children. And my goodness, when you take small children, they ask some embarrassing questions. You know, parents, you have these awkward moments. When your children ask some stupid questions, not stupid, they want to know, and then you don't know what to say. For example, we went on a down south holiday, and then myself and Simfi was in the pool, and this foreign couple were kissing and hugging, and Simfi was like, "What are you doing? What are they doing there?" Huh? You know, and you don't know what to say at that time. So like that, when you come with a respectable family comes with children and, you know, young girls, and when they see these things happening in hotels and motels and guest houses and houses, parents were in a very awkward place and they don't know how to handle their situation. So for such people in Corinth, they used to have tents, making was a trade in Corinth. Why? Some of these respectable families didn't want to stay in such places. So they would hire these tents, and there used to be like common places with wells and public toilets where it can be used by anyone. So these people can pitch their tents in such places and use the well and the toilets, and they can stay separately. So tent making and tent hiring was a big business in Corinth. Another reason tent making business or tent hiring business was flourishing in Corinth is because there was inflow of a lot of people into this city. Corinth used to be a city full of foreigners flowing in, and there are seasons where all the hotels are full. All the hotels are overflowing. All the guest houses are overflowing. All the houses are overflowing. So these visitors who come used to hire a tent and pitch them and stay in those tents and go back enjoying the holiday. So this is tent making was only happening big time only in Corinth. So now I have seen people say Paul was into tent making, and that was his job. And while tent making, he spread the gospel everywhere. No, he was making only tent in Corinth, precious people of God. Now people take that, servants of God take that out of context and say, pastors must do business. Why? Paul did business. These are taking out of, only Paul did tent making in Corinth. Show me in any other place in the Bible where Paul is doing tent making and business, doing business and serving. Now, this is how servants of God twist the scripture, misconstrue the scripture, and use it for their advantage and become businessmen. Their main focus is business, but they take covering under their religious service. But their main focus is not serving people, not being a servant leader. Their main focus is making money, but they take their covering through this religious cloak. This is what is happening, precious people. But Paul only did tent making in Corinth, because tent making was only in Corinth because of the background of the city and what was happening in the city. So, precious people of God, when Paul came to Corinth, Priscilla and Aquila, they were tent makers and they were preaching the gospel. So Paul found them and Paul joined with them and started working with them and started making tent. Only in Corinth, only in Corinth. So don't be misled by some of these preachers who are saying Paul was a businessman and you also have to do business and make money and become a million and billion, and all of that is rubbish, precious people. God. Paul's main focus was ministry. His main focus was spreading the gospel, not making money. This is how they take things out of context and mislead people. Okay? So, this was the reason why tent making was a very lucrative business in the city of Corinth. So during that time, this business, tent making business, was only available in Corinth, and some Christians, without having proper understanding, says that Paul was doing business right throughout his life. No, he only did it in Corinth. So precious people of God, tent making business was a very lucrative and a famous business in Corinth, and that's why Aquila and Priscilla were involved in tent making. Now, the citizens in Corinth also were not that educated people. Okay? The citizens in Corinth were not that educated people. They didn't give priority to education. Their main thing was business. So they didn't struggle to educate their children because they wanted their children to do business, because business was thriving in Corinth. So the parents who had hotels and rest house and their houses were given on, the rooms were rented, and then they have artifact shops and street businesses. They train their children more on business than education. So if the Corinthians, their ideology was that if their children know to count money and keep accounts of money, that's more than enough for them, because the business was bringing them a lot of money. So, precious people of God, Corinthians were not much educated and they were rich. This was their background. So, precious people of God, now you will agree with me that you cannot teach things easily to uneducated people. Also, it is more difficult to teach things to rich people because they are pride. They are full of pride. Now, Corinth city was the combination of both. It is very difficult to teach the uneducated, and also it's very difficult to teach the rich, because they are pride, they have money. So just imagine, Corinth was the combination of both. They were not much educated people and they were very rich. Now, in addition to that, precious people of God, they work so hard 24/7. They are so busy. They were so busy people making money, because Corinth was a city that was always busy because of ships coming different times, and the city was always busy, 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 busy. People were so busy running hotels, running motels, guest houses, street vendors, street business and artifact shops, prostitution business, and all of this happening. Corinthians were very busy people. They were uneducated and they were rich. Okay? Now you can understand why it was so difficult to preach the gospel to this city. Paul stayed 18 months in Corinth, struggling to preach and teach to the people in the city. Now, when you read the Corinthians, you understand why Paul has to write such letters to the Corinthians, which he never wrote such letters to any other churches. Now you will understand. Paul was very strong, coming out with very strong words when it came to the Corinthian church. Why? They were not that educated, but they were rich and they were busy people. They were don't care people. So church, Paul was pastoring the Corinthian church, was such a struggle, such a challenge, because of the background of the city, precious people of God. I hope that you are learning. This is why you see so much of conflicts in the church of Corinth. So many issues. Now you will understand the letter when you read it with the background information. Now, when it comes to Corinth, one says, I belong to Paul. The other one says, I belong to Peter. The other one says, I belong to Apollo. Another one says, I belong to Christ. Paul had so much of a problem with the Corinthians than any other church. There were a lot of misunderstandings, arguments, so much of problems in the Corinthian church. Then when it comes to Lord's table, there was a lot of confusion. And when the pulpit, it was said tomorrow, we are going to have the Lord's table. These fellows brought food from home because these guys were rich and they started eating in the house. And then Paul has to write, don't think kingdom of God is eating and drinking. They were trying to bring food from and all sorts of foods in front of them in the church, trying to celebrate the Lord's table and ignoring the ones who didn't have. So there was such confusion in the Corinthian church because they were not that educated, but they were rich. And also, precious people of God, there was problem with the Lord's table, the communion. Then they have a lot of marital problems because of prostitution in the Corinth city. Marriage was not sacred in the Corinth city. So what happens is, precious people of God, just think, the Corinth city, lot of foreigners come and lot of seamen come, ship captains come, and these girls in Corinth would look at them, and they were smart and well good looking and all of that. They fall in love with them, and then these men sleep with these girls, and then they get married, and then that man leaves in a few days. So now these girls are just left alone, and that this man doesn't come for many months or years, but they are now married to this man. And according to the Corinthian culture, the girls have to submit to the father as long as they are not married. But after they are married, they have the freedom. The father has no control over the girls. So this is one of the reasons that the girls also wants to quickly get married. If not, you know, the father say, don't turn, don't sit, don't stand up, don't look at that man. Because prostitution was big time in Corinth city. The fathers were trying to control the daughters. Good families were trying to control the daughters. And then the daughters, when they grow up, they want to have the freedom. So what the only way out was quickly get married. And then they see some man foreigner coming and they get married. And that man leaves after some time. So marriage wasn't sacred. In Corinth, it was like something, a way out, or something that was, you know, not seen as something very holy and sacred in Corinth. So Paul had to write one chapter on chapter 7, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, about marriage. Are you with me, church? So now when you read Corinthians chapter 7, you will have a better understanding. Then there was a problem with women covering their heads. Okay? Women covering their heads. Now, in Corinth, there was an ancient Greek goddess called Aphrodite. There was, in Acro-Corinth, there was a temple of Aphrodite. In Acro-Corinth, she was a Greek, ancient Greek goddess. And there was a place called Acro-Corinth, and in that place, there was a temple for this goddess named Aphrodite. Now, this goddess, in the temple, she had about 1,000 women as devotees, but they have to do prostitution in the temple. Why? When these men come into the temple, these women has to sleep openly with the men in front of this goddess, so that the goddess' heart is so happy and she blesses the city of Corinth. This was the belief. Can you believe? These are true stories. Now you read, I am not making up, precious people of God. You read about you do a research about the Corinth city. You do a detailed research about the Corinth city. All of this is there. So they have a women, 1,000 women in the temple of Aphroditus doing prostitution openly in front of all devotees who are there. They sleep with men in front of this goddess so that the belief is that Aphroditus will bless the Corinth city. Now what happens, precious people of God? Listen, very interesting. These men who come, like seamen or men from foreign country, come and see this. If there are beautiful women among these 1,000, if there are beautiful women, what happens is they sleep with these women and they take them home. They say, come with us, let's go. So now they're short of 1,000, because 1,000 number has to be always there. So what happens is there are men in the temple. Now their duty is to fill the gap. Okay, so if like 10 women left, 990 women are there, but 10 is the shortfall. What happens is the men who are in charge of these women in the temple come to the city, okay, and they come to the city and call the prostitutes in the city. Anyone, are you coming to the temple, to the goddess temple? There, are you willing to come? So these prostitutes who are in the city say, no, business is good here, we are not coming. And then there are some who might say, okay, I'm coming. So they need to bridge the gap. So they take women from the city to the temple to always bridge the shortfall. It was the practice. So what happens is, when these men from the temple who are looking for prostitutes come, sometimes they don't know who is a prostitute and who's not a prostitute. So they can come and ask from a good woman who's a wife of a man and from a respectable family, might come, another, are you coming to the temple? And just see how bad she will feel. Now, for example, it is a man is waiting there and this fellow comes and asks his wife, another, are you coming? How will the man feel? He feel like hammering the fellow. So this was the practice in Corinth. So what happens, the citizens, good citizens of Corinth, wrote to the emperor of Rome and said, you have to do something about this, because good women from respectable families feel very awkward to come to the public, and they, when they are asked, are you coming for prostitution to the temple, they're feeling very yucky and upset about this, and they are devastated. You have to do something about it. And then what did the emperor do? He said, if you're not a prostitute, if you're from a good family and you're a wife and a daughter of a good family, when you come to the public, you must cover your head. That was the law that was passed for Corinth. Okay, for the Corinthian city, the law was passed because of this, you know, men who are coming and asking, to identify the women who are true wives and women who are coming from respectable family, to distinguish them from prostitutes, they had to cover their heads. Okay, so then when the head is covered, these men will come and not ask, another, are you coming for business? He won't ask. Okay, so now what has happened, precious people of God, in Corinth? Church has been established. Okay? People experienced Christ and they became part of the church. And when they came into church, the born-again experience and the salvation and the liberty and the freedom that the Christians had allowed the women not to cover their head, because freedom is there in the church. In the church there is liberty. So they started church in houses, and that got filled in. So then they went into a private hall, and that's got filled in, and it started to overflow. Okay, so now women in Corinth city who are part of the church, who are, when Sunday service is happening, when they are outside the hall, okay, sitting in the service, this man comes and sees these women who are seated without covering head while the service, you know, just imagine how it would be. And this was disgusting in the church. So they wrote to Paul and said, look here, when the service is going on, women have not covered their head, and this, you know, fellows come and they call the women in the church. What are we to do? So then Paul says, look here, you better cover your head when you come to church. Yes, you have freedom in Christ. You have liberty in Christ. Because of the culture in the Corinth city, for God's sake, women, cover your head. If not, that fellow is going to come and say, hey, mother, are you coming? On Sunday, we are seated in church. So this is the reason why Paul said, cover your heads. And Paul said, if you can't cover your head, shave off your head. Why? Because when the glory of a woman is her hair, precious people of God. And when the woman loses her hair, it's a dishonor and a disgrace for her. And Paul says, if you don't cover your head, it's a disgrace for you. That's what Paul meant by that. It's a dishonor for you, because if that fellow comes and calls. So now understand, precious people of God, what was the reason for Paul to write to Corinth church to cover, for females to cover their head, is because of the culture. Now what happens? Churches are directly taking this and applying. Even today in many churches, some pastors force on believers saying, you must cover your head. Paul says, Paul kiwe Corinth city niza. Paul never writes covering of head to any other churches. Now, precious people of God, understand this. After me revealing this, don't go and judge women who cover their heads on Sundays. Vanda, I'm bowing before you and asking, please don't judge any women who are covering their heads. Let them cover. Nothing wrong. If you don't cover, please, women who are covering their heads, please don't judge the women who are not covering their heads. You know the reason why Paul said for women to cover their heads, because of, he only wrote it for the women in Corinthian city. I showed you the reason. Are you getting what I'm saying? Now, if a church asks me to come and preach, and that church's practices covering of head, if I take Tanu, I will say, Tanu, for God's sake, cover your head and come. I will not say, you know, come as the way you are. Because that's the culture of the church. Let's respect it. Let's not judge it. And the churches who are covering their, practices covering the head of women, don't look down on churches that are not practicing it. Because we know the reason why Paul wrote to cover the head for the, only for Corinthian women. Why? Because of the prostitution that was happening and the law that was passed. Are you with me, church? And Paul says, cover it for the sake of the angels. Now, there is a translation problem there. Angelos is the Greek word. Paul is not referring to the angels. What your head got to do with angels, tell me? A woman's head, what it has got to do with angels? He's referring to these guys, the messenger who's coming to pick women and go for prostitution. Now, when we were translating it, he has said angels. Now, some of you may not agree with me, but don't fight with me. Don't argue with me. If you don't agree with me, that's perfectly okay. Let you keep your belief, let me keep my belief. Because I don't see any connection with a woman's head and angels up in heaven. When Paul says, cover your head for the sake of the translation, angels is a messenger, is the messenger that fellow who's coming from Aphrodite's temple. That's what he meant. Because women's head and angel has nothing to do with, and there's no connection. Angel means messenger. Okay? So, I hope now when you read Corinthians that you will understand. You will have a better understanding. Can you remember that when I started the Bible study, I told you, I warned you, some of the things that I'm going to reveal is going to unsettle all the belief system that you had all of these years. Some of the things that I'm going to reveal is going to totally unsettle you, I said. So if you are a woman covering head, please go ahead. But don't judge a woman who's not covering his head on Sunday. And if you're a woman who doesn't cover your head, don't judge on the woman who covers the head on Sunday. You believe what you believe, but we know the reason why Paul only wrote to the Corinthians for women to cover the head, that there be no confusion. Okay, so now the problem is when the Roman government to pass this law to cover the heads, the young girls would have not liked it. Am I right today also? Young girls don't like some of these things, you know, because of fashion. So they were happy to come to church without covering their head. And this messenger fellow comes and says, you know what that? Are you coming, Aphroditus? And the church leadership was thoroughly disgusted, and they were angry, and they were so annoyed with these women. For Paul says, okay, for peace's sake, cover your head because of the law. Okay? I hope that this is clear. And also, when you look at Corinth City was filled with erotic love and filial love. Erotic love is sexual love. And filial love is a friendship love. Hug and go, hug and leave, hug and enjoy and depart. Kind of friendship love and sexual love, erotic love. So Corinth City always looked at love like that. Enjoy, have friendship, sexually enjoy, depart. But Paul says, I'm going to write one chapter on love, agape, to show the Corinthian people what is true, genuine, God kind of love. And he wrote a chapter 13 on love because of the love that was practiced in Corinth. Okay? And then, precious people of God, Corinth City was a multinational people coming city. So there are different languages spoken. Okay? Because people from Europe, people from Asia, people from Africa, and many parts of the world, because of this port, or harbors, they came into these cities, and Corinthian people were used to a lot of foreign languages. Okay? So when people started speaking in tongues inside the church, it became like a joke. They thought, menna tava language ekak ævilla. Because they were used to listening to so many languages. So it was not considered as sacred. Just another language. So they thought tongues is just another human language. So Paul on chapter 14 start to write on tongues and gifts. And he says, if at all you're speaking in tongues, you must interpret it. Okay, so now somebody today can really suppress and say, you cannot pray in tongues in church. Why Paul wrote to the Corinthians is because of that reason. Now you can't take that and say, no, don't ever speak in tongues in church. Don't pray in tongues in church. And you can suppress the gift in a person. But Paul wrote for that reason. That if you pray in tongues or speak in tongues, you must interpret it. Because otherwise it's becoming a joke. Otherwise it is considered as another language. Because of what was happening in the Corinthian city. So precious people of God, if you really understand the first letter of Corinthians, Paul wrote to the Corinthians, you must understand about the city of Corinth and the background. If you want to understand, now most of you, your eyes are opened. Your understanding is enlarged. And now you get a better understanding when you read the letter of Corinth, the second letter after Romans, 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. Now also precious people of God, now you see in, let's read, we didn't read a scripture today, so let's read one and I'll show you some example. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, 1 to 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 to 3. Let's read. Bible study, kiyawanne epa eka scripture at least. Bible study. Oh, see Pastor Rajah doing Bible study in one verse even. So let's read. It is actually reported that there is a sexual immorality among you. Writing to the church, huh? Paul is writing to the church. He's saying, it is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that even pagans do not tolerate. A man is sleeping with his father's wife. Now, precious people of God, in Corinth, having too many wives is just another normal thing, ordinary thing. Yes, three wives, four wives. Why? It's a morally corrupted city. So what happens is, in the church, a man is sleeping with his stepmother. Okay, now watch. And Paul is saying, you are proud. Why? In Corinth, it is not something bad. So one fellow says, hey, you know that fellow in the church? He's sleeping with his stepmother. How is that so? It's a joke and it's like kind of proud thing. Why? They were so used to that immorality. It's not immoral for them. So Paul is saying, you fellows, you're proud of this. Shouldn't you rather have gone into mourning and have put out of your fellowship the man who has been doing this? By now you should have put this man out, but you are, without mourning, you are proud and you're talking about it. For my part, even though I am not physically present, I am with you in spirit. As one who is present with you in this way, I have already passed judgment in the name of our Lord Jesus on the one who has been doing this. Paul saying, physically I am not there, but spiritually I am there with you in the spirit, and I have passed judgment on this man. He must be put out of the fellowship. Why? Corinth city is so corrupted, for them this is nothing. It's a normal practice. And it has crept into the church. And church also just accepts it and don't take any action. So Paul is coming very strong with the letter. So this is why you see Paul coming so strong on the Corinthian church with certain statement only exclusively written to the Corinthian church. Why? Because they were not much educated. They were rich and proud, and they were morally corrupted. Okay? Now today, if you see, so many churches are endorsing living together. They are endorsing LGBTQ movement. Because why? Their country has legally accepted it, approved it. So therefore, churches are also saying, nothing wrong. You can stay together. That's perfectly okay. You're being a lesbian. That's perfectly okay. You come to church because you are born with it. That's perfectly okay. You are homosexual. That's okay. God loves you. Yes, God loves. But you can't come to church and remain the same. You come to church. Lesbians can come. Homosexuals can come. All sorts of people can come. But you cannot remain the same when you come to church. But what churches are doing today is, you can come and remain the same because that's who you are. That's perfectly okay. So that was in Corinth. Because the city was so sexually corrupted and immoral, when people started doing that inside the church, church didn't bother to confront. Church was okay. It's perfectly okay. And we are proud of you. These things have been done. Paul came very strong at the church. He put the fellow out of the fellowship. It's not an accepted practice in the house of God. Okay? So precious people of God, when they read the first letter of Corinthians written by Paul to the church, they started speaking against Paul. Why? He's coming hard against the church for their immorality, for their stupid practices. Paul, when he wrote the first letter, the church started coming against Paul. And they started saying, yes, he is the one who established the church. He's the one who gave birth to the church. He was with us. But he's no longer with us. He's somewhere else. Why is he trying to poke his finger into our affairs? Why is he trying to put his nose into our affairs? Who is he? We don't subject to ourselves to him. We don't submit to him. And they were coming against Paul when Paul wrote this strong letter, 1 Corinthians. So when this news reached Paul, Paul wrote the 2 Corinthians. And you know what is 2 Corinthians all about? Paul defending his apostleship and the authority of the apostle. That's what 2 Corinthians is all about. Okay? Paul was saying, okay, you're coming against me. Let me show you who I am in Christ. I am an apostle, called by God, appointed by God, anointed by God. And you know what is the authority of an apostle? He's writing it to the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians. So that is 2 Corinthians. Now you know what is 1 Corinthians and what is 2 Corinthians. And I stop there. Okay, we are done with Corinthians. Now you start reading 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. You will have a super understanding why Paul is writing certain things. With this background, I gave you a very comprehensive background about the Corinthian city. And now when you read 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, you will have a good understanding, precious people of God. Next week, we go to third letter of Paul, Galatians. Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for this amazing Bible study time. Thank you for the revelations that you showed us. Thank you, Lord, that your children are maturing day by day, deepening their understanding in your scriptures. And thank you, Father, even as they spend time with your word, thank you, Father, that your word will heal them, deliver them, bless them, restore them, and Lord, make them more than conquerors. And even right now, while they were listening to your word, let them be healed, set free, liberated by the power of your word, God. Thank you, Father. Lord, thank you for every home that is connected right now and the homes that will connect after. May your grace abundantly come over them. May their anointing rest upon them. Let there be deliverance and breakthroughs by the power of the Spirit and the word of God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Lord, we give you all the praise and honor and glory to you. I take the authority of the name of Jesus, and I take the authority of the power of the stripes of Jesus, and I command healing to you right now. Lay your right hands wherever you are sick and be healed right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And may the Lord touch you from head to toe and heal you of every nerve condition in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. May there be breakthrough financially. May there be a breakthrough of peace and sanity at home. I arrest every evil demonic activity in your home and I cast it out in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Every child that is oppressed by the evil spirit, I command deliverance right now by the power of the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that you are in our midst right now, that you're moving so powerfully in our midst now. Thank you, Lord, that your glory is going to be revealed in your homes and in the lives of your people. You are victorious and you are in our midst, God. And we will be victorious. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray and everyone say amen and amen. God bless you. Looking forward to see you on Friday Bible study. Timothy couldn't do the Bible study the last 2 weeks because he was so caught up with the Tamil Sinhala service starting. Behind scenes, he was doing a lot of work. And hopefully this Friday, we will be able to start the Friday Bible study. Share the news of Tamil Bible study on Thursday with people who are Tamil speaking so that we can build people in the Word of God. And also share the good news of our Tamil Sinhala service started last Sunday. Every Sunday at 7 a.m. Malsara reception, all at Dehivala. We are having our Tamil and Sinhala service. The address and the flyer, if you want to get it, speak to Dilrukshi. Introduce people who are unchurched and people who have never come to know the Lord, who are Tamil and Sinhala speaking. Direct them to the services, because Father's house is all about teaching the undiluted word and displaying the power of the Spirit. Amen. God bless you. And I hope to see you on Thursday with the Tamil Bible study. And then on Sunday, I hope to see all of you. God bless you. Have a blessed week.
If you curse me, then I will bless you. If you hurt me, I will forgive. And if you hate me, then I will love you. I choose the Jesus way. If you're helpless, I will defend you. And if you're burdened, I'll share the weight. And if you're hopeless, then let me show you there's hope in the Jesus way. I hope.